completed, Christina has travelled on to Liverpool, where she's planning to take a break, quite literally. In the heart of the city lies Thurston's, a family business synonymous with the sport of billiards since 1799. As well as making traditional tables, the shop houses a world-class collection of billiards and snooker heritage, built up by the late owner, Norman Clare. Christina has come along to meet his son, Peter, to find out more.
This looks amazing.
Thank you.
Absolutely amazing.
Part of our showroom, but it's has some of our collection in it as well.
Because I believe you're a bit of a dying breed.
Oh, you could be, yes.
A rare breed.
A rare breed.
Rather than dying breed. Sorry.
Snookered. Time for a potted history. In mid-14th century Europe, beer was a lawn game, similar to croquet. By the following century, it had moved indoors and been raised onto a table, the green baize representing the grass that it had once been played on. But early tables didn't have pockets, and that wasn't the only thing that was different about the game. Cue Peter.
Until about late 1890s, there wasn't a specified size for a table, so you could have had a table which was 16 foot long by only 4 foot wide or whatever else. It wasn't until quite late on that it was actually specified that a table was basically 12 foot by 6 foot.
Right, okay.
And sort of a billiard table, which is what we play snooker on.
Was it the
thing that they
look like golf clubs.
They do, rather, and there's an example of one. It's called a mace.
The early cue is just a small part of the quirky collection thought to be one of the largest in the world.
When did the mace, or how did it develop? Because I assume it then became a cue.
It did, yes. If you take the mace, which we've got one over here, if you take that as being a mace, this is quite a good quality one,
right.
In that it's also got sighting line down it. And the idea would be that you would stand something like that and it was a push shot.
As the game developed, players wanting to attempt more skillful shots used the tail end of the mace. The French word for tail is le cœur, hence the cue got its name.
Anywhere where there's been a UK influence and they use UK-style cues, we'll still have a flat on the butt.
Flat butt, yeah. So you could push.
Yeah.
But is that legal now?
It wouldn't be now, no.
Balls. Now, what about billiard balls?
We think that the early balls were made of wood and then they went to ivory as being the thing. And then in about the 1860s, I think it was, so many elephants were being killed for ivory, for the ivory trade in general, not just for billiards, that there was a prize offered in the States of $10,000 for somebody to invent something to replace the ivory billiard balls. And this is one of the first things made in plastic and sold in plastic commercially was billiard balls.
Brilliant.
By the mid-19th century, billiards wasn't just a game for the aristocracy. It was a game for every man and every woman. But now there were many variations. Carrom, snooker, pool, each putting a different spin on the cue sport. But anyone of note would have had a table of their own.
So, Peter, any really famous people that I would have heard of that have got a Thurston's table?
Yes, Charles Dickens. And he bought a few accessories off us, so they actually kept the check. Although it's been slightly damaged, we've got it here.
My goodness!
And it's on Coutts Bank.
Of course.
And for £9, 4 shillings.
£9, 4 shillings. That was for his table?
Well, I think it's for accessories for his table, yes.
And dated 1860-something. Yeah. So it's actually signed by Dickens?
Yes.
That's amazing. Well, that is a claim to fame.
And it can all be found right here in the old Curiosity Shop.